Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Business of Belonging, How to Make Community Your Competitive Advantage, by David Spinks, narrated by Christopher Douyard. Limit of Liability and Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Foreword. In 2016, I agreed to speak at the CMX Summit in the Palace of Fine Arts in San Francisco. It was still a relatively new conference, just a couple of years old, and it proclaimed to focus entirely on community management. As a longtime community founder, I did not know what to expect. At every other startup or marketing conference I had been to, and I had been to a lot, community building was usually a footnote on the agenda. But from the moment I arrived, I knew this event was different. Everywhere I turned seemed to be conversations, people, and products focused on building community. To my shock, as I sat in a dense crowd of hundreds of people, I felt something I hadn't felt since I started building my community 6 years before. True professional belonging. The conference was started by David Spinks. We had first met a few weeks before the conference, and I immediately recognized that he cared about and deeply understood what I cared about, building communities. But the way he spoke about community and how it would change the world of business wasn't something I'd heard anyone talking about at the time. He was sure that in the near future, every business would be building community, and he was dedicating his life to that cause. My own journey of building a community-driven business dates back to 2010, when a few friends and I began hosting events called Startup Grind in my small office in Mountain View, California. At first, it didn't seem like much of anything special, just a couple dozen startup people meeting up and networking. But the momentum soon started to build. 10 people at the first event turned into 20, then 50, then 100, then 250. At one event, an attendee approached me and asked if he could launch a Startup Grind chapter in Los Angeles. The culture we had built at Startup Grind around the values of giving first, helping others, and making friends were actually very unique in the startup world at the time. They wanted to bring that mentality to LA. And it worked. Soon, the LA chapter was growing quickly. After the success in LA, we started inviting our members to kick off their own local chapters in their city. Today, Startup Grind has 600 active chapters in 120 countries. We've hosted 15,000 events led by 2,000 volunteers. Most of what we did was self-taught, fumbling around in the dark until we figured out enough wrong ways to build our community to find the right things to do. As a battle-scarred community builder, discovering CMX and meeting David that day in 2016 was like returning home after being gone on a long, impossible journey. At CMX, for the first time, I was in a place where other people were speaking my community language. Each attendee seemed to be engaged in their own epic community-building journey. I had found myself nodding at every speaker's insights and having to hold back on all my questions. When people ask me to describe David Spinks, I affectionately tell them that he is the Yoda or Dalai Lama of community, much to his chagrin. This isn't just because David is one of the most genuine and thoughtful people I have met, but because he is the first person I met that put frameworks and science behind the things I had been building. The Spaces model was the first true business case for building a community. The language and tools he put forth in industry have become staples in the process of building branded communities today. Over the last 10 years, David's advice has been sought by the very best companies in the world to help them figure out how to craft and grow an authentic community with their customers. Leaders from the top communities come to CMX to dispense their knowledge to the rest of the industry. Tens of thousands of decision makers have already benefited from David's experiences and frameworks, but probably no one more than me. In a veiled excuse to spend more time working near him, in early 2019, my company, Bevy, acquired CMX so that we could be part of the community revolution that he helped pioneer. Having worked side by side with him since then, I have been thrilled to see the business of belonging finally come to light as our company has grown 10 times since David joined, in large part due to implementing many of the principles that he shares in this book. I truly believe that this book will become the Bible that every community builder reads. When competitors' product features and functionality are the same as yours, having a community is, as David eloquently says, the one thing they can't copy. At a time when no one wants to click on another digital ad, your community can fire up your sales channel or turn a detractor into a promoter. If I had this book when I started Startup Grind, I can only imagine how much farther I would be and how many mistakes I could have avoided. As you study and apply the lessons in this book, hopefully you will feel what I felt at that first CMX event I attended. A connection to the people who have trodden the path you're on or embarking on, and that there is a fountain of support and lessons you can benefit from to help you on your own community-building journey. Derek Anderson, co-founder, Startup Grind, Bevy. Introduction. The internet was where I first found a sense of belonging. It was back in middle school. I was a kid growing up in the suburbs of New York City, and didn't fit in. Both of my parents were immigrants. My dad was born in Ireland, moved to Israel where he met my mother, got married, moved to the U.S., and I was born 1 year later. We didn't have a deeply rooted social network in our local community. We were new and different. We had some extended family nearby, but most of our family lived in other countries. I was a bit awkward and tried too hard to fit in. I was bullied for being Jewish and having a parent with an accent. As I grew up, I found myself disconnected from early childhood friends, and I struggled mightily to find my social rhythm. Despite not fitting in, I was still someone who felt strongly drawn to other people. I loved organizing and being a part of social activities. I loved meeting new people. For better or worse, I needed people to like and engage with me in order for me to feel like myself. And I would get deeply depressed when I was turned away by the groups I cared most about. When I couldn't find community locally, I was forced to search elsewhere. I ended up finding it in online video games. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 4, THPS4, was one of the first console games developed specifically to be played online. I picked it up and quickly became addicted. In truth, I think I was more addicted to the social network on the game than the game itself. I became one of the top competitive THPS4 players in the world and had developed a strong reputation on the game. I decided with a couple of friends to start up a clan, and we quickly rose to the top of the clan rankings. We launched a website and a forum, which became one of the most popular online communities for THPS4 players at the time. We had a really tight-knit community with lots of shared stories and inside jokes. I once won a personal meet-and-greet with Mr. Hawk himself and asked him if he could sign a Jell-O pudding pack for me. It was an inside joke in our community, and we planned to give it away in a contest. He looked very confused when I handed it to him, but just kind of smirked and signed it anyway. Probably not the best idea to get a valuable autograph on a perishable good, but it was totally worth it for the reaction from the community. I was just 14, still in middle school, and would sprint home every day to get online, play games, and manage a community with hundreds of active members. We hosted competitions, created video content, dealt with trolls and spam, launched and relaunched forums, empowered moderators from the community, all the things that anyone who manages an online community does today. I had not only found belonging, but I was creating community and belonging for others. It was the greatest feeling in the world. From that point on, I was hooked on community building. I became obsessed with how the internet could be a platform for community and started engaging in every online community I could find. I joined more gaming communities, started sharing poetry and journaling online, and became an early adopter of every new social platform. It was at college that I started connecting community to the world of business. I was a business administration major. The problem was, all the courses in the program felt super outdated. We were being taught things that worked for businesses 10 years ago. Meanwhile, I was witnessing a social revolution taking place on the internet. Blogging was wildly popular at the time. Every college student in the U.S. was using Facebook every day. A strange social platform called Twitter was starting to grow in popularity. It seemed obvious to me that business would all be driven by online communities and social spaces. But none of my classes even mentioned the internet. So I pitched the business department on launching a course focused on online communities. They said no. Womp womp. Luckily, my computer science teacher was more receptive and said if I helped create the curriculum, he would make it a course in his department. The next semester, we kicked off the school's first online community and social media course. I soon had the opportunity to start doing paid community building work, organizing community events, and programming for the college union. I also launched our school's first ever official blog, which is still going today. Becoming a community professional. While in college, I started a personal blog to write about what I was learning in the world of community, social internet, and business, and started making a name for myself. The founders of a startup called Scribnia, Russell D'Souza and Jack Gretzinger, read one of my blog posts and emailed me asking me to be their first community manager. Just like that, I had my first official job building community for a business. It turned out that building community for a business was a lot different from building a community for a video game or for college students. Customer communities were a totally different beast. Members' motivations were different. Expectations were higher. I had to have goals and metrics and report on my success. I had to become a community professional. No problem, I thought. I'll just find mentors and training programs to teach me how to build community on a professional level. Well, it turned out there really weren't many people with experience building communities for companies back then. People didn't understand what it meant to build community for a business. They were still thinking about it like traditional marketing, using social platforms to build an audience rather than connect people to each other. It was truly a brand new profession. I realized I was largely on my own. Slowly, I started meeting other people who, like me, were building real communities for businesses. I ended up starting a blog and job board called thecommunitymanager.com with my friends Jen Peedy and Brett Petersell, who were also community managers. We started publishing regular articles about what we were learning and invited other community professionals to do the same. We organized meetups and just started creating spaces for people who did this kind of work to connect and support each other. My role is the director of community for a startup called Zarly and started a couple companies of my own, including a somewhat spontaneous 2-year swing at building an online cooking school called Feast with my roommate, Nadia Egbal. After giving it a good go, we were running out of investor money and losing interest. It was looking like Feast was going to be a bust. Nadia would go on to become a principal at Collaborative Fund and work on community at GitHub and Substack. And I had a new opportunity fall into my lap that would define the rest of my career. Building the community industry. As fate would have it, my friend and fellow entrepreneur Max Altshuler came to me with a proposition at the perfect time. I had told him in the past that I had a dream of hosting a conference entirely focused on the community industry. He wanted to help me start it. This was 5 years after I got my first community manager job and more businesses were starting to invest in community. I was meeting hundreds of community professionals, some of whom were doing incredible work for well-known brands. But their work was still going unnoticed in the broader business community. I felt that if we could organize a legitimate conference for community professionals, it would bring more credibility and awareness to the community industry, help community professionals level up their work, and motivate more companies to invest in community. Max said he would handle all the logistics for the event since he had experience running a conference, and I could focus on curating speakers and marketing. I figured, why not? I have anything to lose, and CMX Summit was born. Launching CMX felt like the culmination of everything I learned and worked on in my life and career. That first event was one of the most powerful community experiences I ever felt. We had 300 people come from around the world. It was the first conference where every single person in the room was building community for a business. Attendees didn't know what to expect. They were so used to being the only community professional at an event and having to explain what they do 100 times because no one understood what community management actually was. We took a very different tone at that event than what community professionals were used to. The title, community manager, was perceived as low value, junior level, nice to have. It wasn't well defined or respected. At CMX, we told them that community would be the future of business and that they're doing the most important work in the world. We put speakers on stage who successfully built community programs up at companies like Lyft, Airbnb, 500 startups, and Apple. We told them community is extremely valuable, their profession is important, and we're at the start of something huge. One attendee from that very first conference, Holly Firestone, who was running community for Atlassian at the time and would go on to lead community teams for Salesforce, wrote many years later about the impact CMX Summit had on her career. I remember pulling up to the event, and I was so excited. I felt like a kid on her first day of school. I remember what I was wearing: white shirt, green jacket, jeans, brown boots, and a bright blue scarf. I remember exactly how the room looked. It was crowded with people in every inch of the space. I just looked around in awe. I couldn't believe that everyone in the room was there for a community management conference. When I think about what was most valuable to me that day, it was that I was surrounded by people with which I didn't need to push back. A huge weight that I had been carrying around was lifted off of me. I finally felt, without a doubt, I was making the right decision about my career. I left feeling inspired and reinvigorated. This was a huge turning point for me. It was the sentiment that we heard from a lot of the attendees that day. It was the first time they were surrounded by people who understood what it meant to be a community professional. It was the first time they felt like there was a real career path for them in the world of business. It was a space where, for the first time, they didn't feel alone in their work. I knew that there was something special happening here and felt like I found the work I was meant to do. I turned my full-time focus to building CMX. We made it our mission to advance the community industry and help community professionals thrive. I wanted community professionals to have all the resources I wish I had when I first kicked off my career in community. The community era has arrived. Fast forward, and the CMX community has grown to tens of thousands of members. We've hosted numerous global conferences and have over 60 local, volunteer-led chapters around the world. I get to do what I love every day: build, research, and teach community. After 5 years of bootstrapping, CMX was acquired by the community and virtual events software platform Bevy, which helped both of us accelerate our growth and impact. I've had the opportunity to work with teams at companies like Google, Airbnb, National Geographic, Red Bull, Facebook, Waze, Udemy, Salesforce, Atlassian, and hundreds more through workshops and consulting. And I've learned a lot about what it takes to launch, manage, and scale successful community programs that create genuine belonging for members and measurable value for businesses. Our prediction at the first CMX summit that community was the future of business has proven true. A recent study by First Round Capital found that 80% of startups today are already investing in community, and 28% consider it to be their moat and critical to their success. In our own study of companies investing in community, 88% said that community is critical to their company's mission. It is hard to find a company today that isn't at least thinking about community. Even with the increased attention, there's still a lot of uncertainty around how to invest in community. There isn't a human out there that would argue that community isn't important. The question isn't whether or not community is important. For a business that has to optimize every dollar spent and ruthlessly prioritize what it focuses on, the question is, why should we invest in community over all the other things that we could be investing in? And once you're ready to make that investment, how does a business build a legitimate community that creates authentic belonging for members while also driving business outcomes? Can you measure it? How do you know it's working? What does a successful community look like? These are the questions I've spent my whole career working to answer. And these days, a week doesn't go by that I'm not asked by a number of businesses who are trying to figure it out. I wrote this book to provide you with the answers. I've been writing this book for 3 years, but gathering the lessons and insights for this book for more than 10 years. It's a collection of everything I've learned and studied in the world of community-driven business. After reading this book, I want you to understand what it means to be a community-driven business. I want you to understand how to drive higher trust, lower costs, and scale every part of the customer and sales journey in a way traditional businesses can only dream. I want you to have everything you need to build real belonging for your people and make community your competitive advantage. Let's do this. Chapter 1. Why Community is the New Competitive Advantage. What does it actually mean for a business to build community? It's such a broad term that's used in so many different ways, it's always difficult to nail down. In every conversation I have with a company asking for advice on their community strategy, I always kick off by asking, "Why are you investing in community?" The majority of the time, this is the first time anyone at the company has had to articulate an answer to that question. So, we're going to start there. In this chapter, I'm going to give you some working definitions of community. We'll talk about the history of businesses investing in community, and I'll help you understand why it's becoming such a prominent part of the conversation today. I'll also share some big-picture concepts that explain why community is such a powerful force for businesses. We're starting high level, and we'll get more and more specific as we move through the book. Let's start off with some history. A customer community is born. Business has been moving in the direction of community for a long time now. In fact, if you go looking for the very first time a business built a community team, you'd have to go back to the early days of the internet. Apple pioneered a new wave of computing, but did you know it was also the very first company to have a community team and build a customer community program? There weren't many places for people to talk to each other online when Ellen Petrie Lienz joined the company in 1981 as a communications specialist, just 5 years after the company was founded. In 1985, after the Mac was launched, Apple was dealing with frustration at the hands of its users, especially those who had committed to the Apple II in the years before the Mac. As the company pivoted toward the Mac in 1984, they felt abandoned, and most of the feedback received from customers came in the form of printed letters mailed to their office. Lienz would respond to these letters directly and started noticing that a lot of the letters had a code on them. When she asked the customers about the codes, she learned that they were access codes for BBS groups, bulletin board systems. Unbeknownst to Apple, their customers were already gathering online on one of the earliest forms of internet forums and talking about their products. Lienz saw an opportunity. She advocated against resistance since going online was uncharted territory for any tech enterprise at that time, for establishing their own BBS node and sharing information from Apple directly with its user communities. Suddenly, they were connected with a global community of customers. It was an uphill battle for Lienz. If you think engaging in online communities is unfamiliar territory for businesses today, you can imagine what it felt like back then. Participating in communities with customers just wasn't something businesses did. Even Apple, who's well known for breaking the mold, was hesitant, largely viewing users as a cost, not a benefit. Ellen fought for making a real investment in community. She would spend a lot of time talking to customers, gathering their feedback, and sharing it internally. After a lot of advocacy, she found a believer in Apple's CEO, John Sculley, who backed taking the voice of the user seriously. With his support, the Apple User Group Connection, AUGC, was born, led by Lienz. I was fortunate enough to be chosen to make this connection, and I couldn't have done it alone, but I did fight for it alone, said Lienz. No one knew anything about it until after I started sharing with users and harnessing the power of their input. The AUGC was a hit, bringing together Apple users from around the world and providing a channel for their voice to be heard. Sculley would host digital discussions in the user groups, sharing updates with users and listening to their feedback. It opened up the curtains in a way businesses just didn't do at that time, and it helped Apple turn the corner on improving customer sentiment. We felt it start to humanize the company at a time when technology was all about the machine, says Lienz. It was a revolutionary mentality for a business to adopt at the time, and a preview of what was to come. The rise of community-driven business. Apple was early to identify an important trend that would accelerate over the next few decades, the growing power of the customer. Back when customers couldn't talk to each other or research products, unless they were more technical and could use tools like BBS groups, companies didn't have to prioritize customer support. If customers had a bad experience, they wouldn't be able to tell too many other people about it. That all changed when customers could suddenly talk to each other online using social networks. They could now share reviews of products, word of mouth was accelerated, and positive or negative sentiment could spread like wildfire. This led to the huge customer service trend, led by companies like Zappos and Amazon. In his book, Delivering Happiness, Zappos CEO Tony Hsieh recalled the radical perspective they had on growing the business. Our philosophy was to take the most of the money we would have spent on paid advertising and invest it into customer service and the customer experience instead, letting our customers do the marketing for us through word of mouth. This was unheard of at the time. And it worked. Zappos would grow to be the internet's largest shoe retailer, and it sparked a revolution in how businesses would look at customers. Putting the customer first became a competitive advantage. This trend grew as social networks continued to give customers more power and access. Companies started hiring full content and social media teams to build trust and to connect more personally with customers. Inbound marketing and customer success was born to proactively invest in helping customers succeed. Businesses started making it a priority to help customers more successfully use their products, improve their skills, and grow in their careers, knowing that a more successful customer is a more loyal customer. But it was still very much one-to-one and one-to-many communication. It would be a company rep talking to a customer directly, or creating content that would be distributed to a large audience. What most companies were failing to do, save for a few exceptions like Apple, was create spaces for many-to-many communication. With one-to-one, you're limited by how many people you can form a deep trust and connection with. With one-to-many communication, you can reach more people, but will lack depth. With many-to-many communication, there is no limit. That's why we're now seeing customer support and content marketing give way to a new era of customer relationships, the customer community. This next phase is all about helping customers and other stakeholders connect to each other. Companies are setting themselves apart by tapping into the collective energy, knowledge, and contributions of your most passionate customers, fans, and partners. When people feel like they're part of a community, it becomes their home. They don't want to leave. And they'll step up to contribute and grow the community in ways you can't imagine. There are few better examples of companies who have tapped into the power of community than Salesforce. Erica Kuhl spent the majority of her 17 years at Salesforce building the community program from the ground up. Kuhl once described herself to me as a bulldog who would not give up on something she believed in. She certainly didn't when it came to community. Much like Ellen Lientz at Apple, the company didn't get it, and she fought a long, uphill battle to get leadership to understand what it meant to build community and why it was such a big opportunity. Luckily for Salesforce, they trusted her and gave her a chance to prove it. She knew that the only true way to get buy-in was with data, and she made it a priority to show how community could impact the bottom line. Whenever she took on a new community project, she made sure it would be something she could measure and tie back to ROI. Over the years, she was able to show how community reduced support costs, increased product adoption, and increased customer spend and retention. She would become Salesforce's first VP of community, and community would get woven into the fabric of every product at Salesforce. There are now over 3 million members in the Salesforce Trailblazer community supporting and educating each other in how to better use the product and grow in their careers. Recent research conducted by the company showed that 82% of its customers found that the community increased the ROI of their investment in Salesforce's tools, and 93% said that it helped them find new products and tools they could use in the Salesforce product suite. Every day, we're seeing more examples of companies driving incredible results by building community. One recent study showed that over half of the Fortune Global 50 and the 50 highest valued startups in the world are investing in community programs. Newer companies that have risen in the community-driven business era have made community a priority from day one and prioritized building community before they even started building a product. Take collaborative design tool Figma as an example. Figma was originally built as a community for designers to meet and communicate. The founders believed that design should be collaborative and live online, so they started building a software product for their community to use. Today, over 1 million designers use Figma, and they're valued at $2 billion after just 8 years in business. The knowledge base app Notion is another great example of a company that has focused on community from day one, creating collaborative platforms for users to share their templates with each other and forming a cult following. Or look at the notes tool Rome Research, whose customers literally refer to themselves as the Rome Cult, and you can see community woven into the fabric of everything they do. We're also seeing the rise of community entrepreneurship, where the community is the product. For many years, large social platforms like Facebook and Reddit had a monopoly on online communities. But we're seeing an explosion of independent community businesses like Indie Hackers, the community for bootstrapping entrepreneurs that was acquired by Stripe, Product Hunt, the community for sharing and discovering new products that was acquired by AngelList, and Her, the community for LGBTQ+ women with over 4 million users. These community-first businesses are growing fast, and they provide a model for financially sustainable communities. The number of companies that make building community a priority is only going to keep growing. Giving customers a true sense of community. Before we go much deeper into the business value, it's important to understand what I mean when I use the term community. Community is a really broad term. If you ask 100 people, what is community? You'll get 100 different answers. It's a shared identity. It's a shared passion. It's people who care about each other. It's a neighborhood. It's religion. It's a belief. It's family. It's a fan base. It's my friends. It's a sports team. The range of definitions of community can literally range from all of the people in the world to just a few, depending on the context. Social scientists and community experts have spent decades working to articulate exactly what makes a group of people a community. The one theory that has always resonated most with me, and the one that has been most influential on recent research in the field of community psychology, is called the sense of community theory, created by social psychologists David McMillan and David Chavis in 1986. The authors describe a sense of community as a feeling that members have of belonging, a feeling that members matter to one another and to the group, and a shared faith that members' needs will be met through their commitment to be together. According to the theory, there are four factors that contribute to a sense of community: membership, influence, integration/fulfillment of needs, and shared emotional connection. Membership. Membership is the feeling of belonging or sharing a sense of personal relatedness and includes five attributes. 1. Boundaries. How do people become members, and what are the boundaries keeping others out? 2. Emotional safety. By building boundaries and including the right people, you create trust and a feeling of safety. 3. A sense of belonging and identification. Members must feel like they fit in and that this is their community. 4. Personal investment. If members contribute or make sacrifices to the community, it enhances their sense of community. 5. A common symbol system. Sharing a symbol, like a sports team jersey or a brand logo, creates a sense of community. Influence. The second element is influence, or a sense of mattering. It has to work both ways, with members feeling like they have influence over the community, and the community having influence over the members. Influence also speaks to the concept of giving first before asking for anything. The theory states that people who acknowledge that others' needs, values, and opinions matter to them are often the most influential group members, while those who always push to influence, try to dominate others, and ignore the wishes and opinions of others are often the least powerful members. So it's important to create an environment in your community where members feel like they have a say in what happens. Each member should know that someone is listening, no matter what, even if it's just the community manager. And for a community to have influence over its members, it simply has to become a place that they care about. It has to provide them with value that they don't want to lose. Integration and fulfillment of needs. This essentially means that by joining a community, members get what they hoped to get by joining. It reinforces the idea that your community, like any other product, needs to solve a problem for its members in order to make it worth their time and contribution. A reward might be something specific, like an answer to a question or networking. Or it could be something a bit more intangible, like a sense of belonging, a feeling of purpose, a new friend, etc. Members need to feel rewarded in some way for their participation in the community in order to continue to contribute. This is why it's important to talk to your users and get a good idea of who they are. Then, you can understand their needs and how the community can best serve them. Shared emotional connection. All healthy communities have a story. Members will have a history of experiences together and the belief that there will be more experiences together in the future. These experiences form a long-lasting emotional connection. That's why a community that goes through a crisis often comes out much stronger, because they've now shared a difficult situation, forging a strong emotional bond amongst members. This factor is believed to be the definitive element for true community by the authors. You can use these four factors to better understand the strength of community that a group has. All groups of people have the potential to be a strong community, but Without clearly defined membership, an exchange of influence, fulfillment of needs, and a shared emotional connection, it's fair to assume that the strength of community amongst a group is pretty weak. There are lots of companies that throw around the term community, using it to describe their customers and audience regardless of whether or not there's an actual deep sense of community amongst the people they're referring to. I urge you to think about how to create a real community for your people, rather than just slapping the title onto everything. Because if you can create a true sense of community for people, that's what will make them care enough to contribute. And that's what will unlock all the business value we'll talk about in this book. The Unrivaled Scalability of Community. When you give people a true sense of community, it motivates them to want to get involved and contribute. Motivate enough people, and community can help you achieve incredible scale. One company that succeeded in scaling by creating a true community for many of its members is Duolingo, led by their incredible global head of community, Laura Nestler. The language learning app does everything with a community-first mindset, and it's enabled them to achieve incredible scale in a relatively short time, having launched publicly in 2012 and offering nearly 100 different courses to their user base of over 300 million. Developing 100 language learning courses takes an incredible amount of resources. Contrast Duolingo with the language learning software Rosetta Stone, which was founded in 1992 and only offers 23 languages. Duolingo did this all with just over 300 employees. Rosetta Stone has over 1,300 employees. Today, Duolingo is privately valued at over $1.5 billion, and Rosetta Stone's market cap is about $700 million. The secret to Duolingo's scale? You guessed it, community. The majority of courses on Duolingo are developed with the help of the community. Duolingo's learning scientists and curriculum experts provide structure and guidance, as well as review all content before it goes live. However, the community contributes the content and translations that make the actual courses.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Playbooks, use the link in the video description.